If I tell you I built a classification model with four classes and it's 90% accurate, what else can you tell me about it? Let's face it, it's nice to have a single metric to summarize the performance of a model, but it's not enough to draw interesting conclusions from it. For example, maybe the model gets one out of the four classes completely wrong. Maybe it's horrible at predicting every single sample from that class, but we can't tell. Now, of course, we can get a ton of useful information from the results of a classification model, but not through the lens of a single metric. We need something else, which leads me to this video where we're gonna talk about confusion matrices, how they work, and how you can use them to improve your work. As the name implies, a confusion matrix is just a table that will tell us where the model is getting confused. Here is one example for a binary classification problem. There are two different ways you can organize a confusion matrix, but I like to do it this way. Here, you'll have the expected value. These are the target classes from my data set, or the actual classes that the model is supposed to predict. Here, you'll have the predicted values coming out of the model. These are the results of the model. So we are gonna read a confusion matrix by starting here with the expected values and then finding out what the predictions were. To look into how we fill this matrix, we have to evaluate our model. Now, keep in mind, usually you won't have to do this process manually because you're gonna have access to tools and libraries that are gonna do this for you. But a great way to understand how a confusion matrix works is to understand how you can create it in the first place. So let's take a look at it. Here are the results of that hypothetical evaluation process. We have 100 samples total on that validation data set. 59 of those samples belong to class A. 41 of those samples belong to class B. When we run the model, we get 52 out of 59 samples correctly predicted as class A. And we get 28 out of 41 samples correctly predicted as class B. With this data, we can now go back to our confusion matrix and fill it up. First of all, we have 100 samples in our validation data set. That means that when we finish filling up the confusion matrix, if we sum every cell, we should get 100. Let's start with the first cell. How many samples were correctly predicted as class A? We go back to the numbers, we get that 52 samples were correctly predicted as class A. Now we know that we had a total of 59 samples, which means that 59 minus 52 is 7 samples that we incorrectly predicted. Notice how I read the cells of the confusion matrix. What we expect goes this way, and what we predicted comes down this way. So how many samples did we expect to belong to class A, but were predicted as class A? That's the way you want to read the confusion matrix. Let's now do class B. How many samples did we expect from class B that were incorrectly predicted as class A? If we go back to our numbers, we got 28 samples that were correctly predicted as class B, and 41 minus 28, that will give us a total of 13 samples that we predicted incorrectly as class A. If you have to, please pause the video, go back and rewatch every question I asked in order to determine where to put each value in the confusion matrix. That's critical to understand how to read them. Now, this is a binary classification problem. Our model is classifying two different classes. In many of the problems where we use binary classification, we care about one specific outcome and want to discriminate that outcome from every other normal instance in our dataset. For example, detecting spam from regular email or detecting fraudulent transactions from legitimate ones. In these problems, we use the term positive to refer to the outcomes we want to detect and negative to refer to everything else. If we go back to our confusion matrix, we can replace the name of the classes with positive and negative. I want you to see what happens now. 52 samples that we expected to be positive came back positive. So these are my true positive samples. 7 samples that we expected to be positive came back negative. So these are my false negative samples. 13 samples that we expected to be negative came back positive. So these are my false positive samples. And finally, 28 samples that we expected to be negative came back correctly as negative. Those are my true negative samples. Cool, huh? Now, for example, I can compute the precision and the recall of my model by just lifting each one of these values out of the confusion matrix. Now, this is great, but we're only working with 2 classes. What happens in a multi-class classification problem? Here is a confusion matrix for a problem with 4 classes. I have A, B, C, and D. As you can see, everything stays the same. We're just accommodating the new classes, and we can read this confusion matrix exactly like we did before. For example, the model made 12 mistakes right here. These were 12 samples that we expected the model to return class D, but instead we got back class C. The model, however, did not make any mistakes confusing class D with class B. It's really good at it. Now, nothing changes with multiple classes. We just have a larger confusion matrix with more information in it. This is awesome, and so far you should have all the information you need in order to read a confusion matrix and start using it. But why would you do that? Why would you go out of your way to create this table? Well, first, I want you to understand that a confusion matrix is just a visualization tool. Its goal is to surface important information that otherwise you wouldn't see. And because it's very effective at doing that, many people use it. Understanding how it works and using it to communicate the results of your model will give you the ability to talk to others, share your work, and understand what you're doing. But more important than that, the information that a confusion matrix puts in front of us, it's critical to understand how a classification model is doing. And better yet, critical to decide the best strategy to improve that model. Remember, the confusion matrix zooms into the results of the model. It shows us every correct and incorrect prediction. And more interesting, it shows us how the model is doing with every class combination. So if I had no other information and I wanted to decide what is the best strategy for my time? Where should I focus in order to improve this model? I will focus on class C because it's the worst performing class with 18 total mistakes. This confusion matrix makes painfully clear where the problems are and where I should focus my time. This is a tool you cannot ignore. But that's not all. Before you even get to this confusion matrix, you have to train a model that doesn't overfit. And for that, I want you to watch this video where I will show you the easiest and one of the most effective ways to prevent overfitting when training a model. That's it. And as always, I'll see you next week.